Hi students, good afternoon to one and all. This is Shijo Michael, PGT Economics from AP Model School, Pulampeta. So today's our topic is microfinance and eradication of poverty. So what is the meaning of the word micro? Yes, it is small. We have already studied in the first year class about microeconomics. Micro means small. So here also, micro finance means small finance. Finance and AME, what do you mean by finance? It's a type of banking activity. Finance means giving credit, accepting savings or transactions, whatever it may be, related to finance. So microfinance is also called micro credit. It's a type of banking service provided to unemployed or low-income individuals or groups who otherwise would have no other access to the financial services. The goal of microfinance is to ultimately give impoverished people an opportunity to become self-sufficient. So, as we have told, this is not aimed for supporting the rich people. This is for supporting the poor people. So it's a way of making them self-sufficient. So that kind of financial tool is known as microfinance. Now let us see what are the examples for microfinance. Actually, you might have heard, especially about Andhra. When we talk about Andhra, you might have heard about DOCRA. Actually, it is not DOCRA. It is DWCRA, Development of Women and Children in Rural Areas. That is a full form of DWCRA. So like that, in other states of India and all over the world, there are some kinds of financial services provided by the microfinancing agencies. We'll talk about that later. So some examples discuss here. That is the DOCRA, Kudumbashree in Kerala, Bandhan Financial Service Limited in West Bengal are examples for this one. The microfinance is seen targeting the poor women who need the funds to establish in their chosen fields. For example, pottery, agriculture, and like how women who can perform with a little financial assistance. They have defaulted much lesser than their male counterparts. In Bangladesh, for example, it has been proved that women default on loans less often. The credit extended to women has a positive impact on household consumption, thereby improving the quality of life for children. Actually, these microfinance institutions are counting on the women empowerment, especially ladies. They are providing these kinds of loans. Why? Because their participation is more, they need more empowerment, and also their payback capacity is more. Actually, they are paying back it at the right intervals. Now, why is it important? Why microfinance is very important for us? Microfinance has been one of the most successful tools to spread financial inclusion among the poor in developing countries. Actually, whenever we talk about the development, we concentrate more on the developing aspects of a country. We have studied in the first chapter what are the areas that we have to concentrate. One of the main problem of a country is poverty. So how to tackle this poverty? One of the tool to tackle poverty is the microfinance. So poor people must be included in the development. So poor people must be developed means they need finance. So that financial inclusion for the poor people in developing countries is provided through microfinance. The idea behind microfinance lies on building specific financial products tailored for a low-income people to allow them to access capital to improve their life and their family's condition. You might have studied about capital. Capital means it is the produced means of production. So they have to purchase, especially the poor people, they don't have money to purchase capital item. So through microfinance, they will be able to purchase such kind of items or tools. So by purchasing that one, they can improve their life, their income and everything, especially their family's conditions all. The concept is much different from aid or social transfer. Aid means help. It is much different. Actually, it is different from any help or social transfer, something like that. This microfinance is considered as empowerment. It means helping them to do themselves. So it is an empowerment tool which enables people to find a solution on their own and invest in their own future. Microfinance institutions in India became very important because they succeeded where the public sector had failed. Public sector means the government. Where the government failed to give such kind of facilities were improved by the provisions of microfinance. They were an answer to poor people's lack of financial opportunities. Now, let us see, discuss about the history of microfinance. So, it has started previously so many years back, but practical successful experiment was conducted by Muhammad Yunus in 1976. Muhammad Yunus, and he was awarded with Nobel Prize also in 2006, noticed that small amounts of loans could make big impact on the poor people's lives. So he started Grameen Bank, Bank of the Villages in Bangladesh, and it was founded in 1983 and was supported by the Central Bank of Bangladesh. And he was very much succeeded providing small loans to the poor people and making their financial conditions improve. Since people in the developing world still largely depend on subsistence farming or basic food trade for their livelihood, significant resources have gone into supporting smallholder agriculture in the developing countries. Mainly in the developing countries, majority of the people are depending upon agriculture. And also they don't use any technology or technological advancement is very poor in this area also because of lack of investment amount. So Muhammad Yunus found that it was very useful for them to provide small loans for in the process of production. Now let us see who is Muhammad Yunus. Muhammad Yunus is a Bangladeshi social entrepreneur, banker, economist, and civil society leader who was awarded with the Nobel Prize for founding the Grameen Bank and pioneering the concepts of microcredit and microfinance. Not only now, microcredit and microfinance, micro insurance is also there right now. Now let us go through the development of microfinance in India. Microfinancing was introduced in India in 1980s as a solution to poverty and to empower women. Despite of its strong potential, the microfinance sector faces challenges related to accessibility in rural India. In India, the first initiative to introduce microfinance was Self-Employment Women's Association, that is SEWA in Gujarat, which established SEWA Bank in 1974. Since then, this bank has been providing financial services to individuals who wish to grow their own business in rural areas. One successful initiative is Kudumbashree, the Kerala State's poverty eradication mission that was launched in 1998. This female-led community organization of neighborhood groups, NGOs, brings women from rural and urban areas together to fight for their rights and helps empower them. Though these NGOs means neighborhood groups, women work on a variety of issues like health, nutrition, agriculture, etc. So in India, it is very important in different areas this micro financing is providing their services. Now let us move to microfinance in Andhra Pradesh. So in nearly 1980s, the government of India launched the development of women and children in rural areas, that is DWCRA, now commonly used as DOCRA, DOCRA like that. You might have heard about that one. And the village women, a group of women, 10 to 15 members group, they gather together and conducts meetings and collects savings and dispersing loans, everything they are doing. This program under the Integrated Rural Development Program, IRDP. Through DWCRA, the program was not very successful in the rest of the country. It was successful in Andhra Pradesh. And also later, the zero interest scheme was first launched by then Chief Minister then N. Kiran Kumar Reddy in United Andhra Pradesh in 2011. But later, when the state was divided or bifurcated, that scheme was discontinued. So under this, the state government bore the interest burden on the loans extended to the women self-help groups. In the women self-help groups, they will give loans also. In that loan, they have to pay with interest. This interest will be paid by the government. That is why it is known as zero interest scheme. Later it was discontinued, but in the line which is election EU promise last year, Chief Minister Y.S. Jagan relaunched the zero interest scheme that would benefit about 91 lakh members of SHGs in 2020. Now let us go through the features of microfinance. So in the textbook, page number 77, you can see these about the microfinance and their features and everything. So here you can see in this slide also, what are the features? There are so many features are there, but in the textbook, we have given only six features. We have to study about that only. First one, borrowers are from the low income group. We have already told that it is aimed towards the poor people and especially towards women, okay, to empower the women. So the first feature is borrowers are from the low income groups. Later I will share this slide with you or PDF form so that you can write the notes. If you want, you can continue with the running notes also. Second point, loans are of small amounts, micro loans. That is why it is known as microfinance. Very small amounts loan, especially maybe 4,000, 5,000, up to 1 lakh maybe. Next, important feature is that short duration of the loans. So they have to pay back the loans taken in the short period, maybe 1 year or maybe within 2 years, like that, not long term loans. Fourth feature, loans are offered without collateral securities. They don't want to give any security for getting the loan. Okay, as a group member, you can avail the loan. That is the benefit of this microfinance. If you are taking a loan from the bank, we have to give some securities on bond paper. We have to sign, not only that one, some other persons, they have to sign for that one. And sometimes they will ask land documents for providing loans, etc. So here in this microfinance, there is no need of collateral securities. Next, high frequency of repayments. Actually, whenever we are taking a loan from the bank, we have to pay once in a month or once in 6 months, like that. But here, maybe every week or every day, like that, the frequency of the repayment is very high, so that the loan will be closed very fastly. Number six, loans are generally taken for income generation purpose. This is very important. Microfinance provides loans for income generation purpose. So using these loans, they cannot just use this money for consumption or any other purchasing any other item like that. They have to purchase the item, that means the capital goods with which they can generate income. For example, to purchase tractor, sometimes to purchase raw materials. So After purchasing the raw material, processing that one, they will get income. So it promotes income generation. That is one of the very important feature. Now let us see, why do we need microfinance or need for the microfinance? Actually, we have studied already that India is a developing country. So India is a developing country means majority of the people in India are poor. So in order to help the poor people only, this scheme was launched. So definitely it will be useful for India. India is the home to almost 1/3 of the world's poor. Total poor in the world's 1/3 is present in India. There are so many poverty alleviation programs are active in India. In India, you will study also later what are the poverty. You might have studied, I think already finished about the poverty alleviation programs. So one of the poverty alleviation program is this one, this micro finance. Now, but these poverty alleviation programs were unable to reach to the poorest of the poor. In that area, microfinance plays a major contributor to provide credit facilities to the poorest of the poor. Thus, it has helped out remarkably in eradicating poverty. Microfinance have been able to increase their income and thereby their standard of living. Microfinance provided loans to the poorest of the poor that help to increase the income of the poor families. Many of the Indians are unaware of banking service. One of the main problem of the Indian poor is that they are not familiar with the banking procedure and they are unable to get loans from the bank. At that time, microfinance institutions serve as a supplementary to banks and in some sense a better one too. These institutions not only offer microcredit, but they also provide other financial services like savings, insurance, remittance, and non-financial services like individual training, counseling, and support to start own business, etc. But all these comes at a cost, and the interest rates charged by these institutions are higher than that of the commercial banks and vary from 10 to 30%. So to provide these microfinance services, they charge some interest rate. It is normally higher than that of the bank rate. Now let us see what are the channels of microfinance. There are two channels. First one, self-help groups, bank linkage program. Number two, microfinance institutions. Now let us see what is self-help group bank linkage program. This is the bank-led microfinance channel, which was initiated by NABARD in India in 1992. This promotes a self-help group, SHG model, in which groups of 10 to 15 members are formed in villages. Usually, women in the village are encouraged to form these groups. So, self-group, first step of the microfinance is the creation of the self-help group. Then this self-help group will be linked with the bank. Bank will give technical assistance and support to these self-help groups. What is this self-help group? This is a group of 10 to 15 members from a village, especially women. The members contribute their savings in the group periodically, and from these savings, small loans are provided to the members. So in this model, first they will form the group, self-help group, then they will share amount, for example, 100 rupees. So 10 members are there means 100 rupees altogether, it will be 1000 rupees. So this 1000 rupees, one of the member can take as a loan. Again, next week they will join together and they will collect this 100 rupees, and again 1000 rupees will be there. Not only that, the one who took the loan, he or she has to repay it with interest. For example, 10 installments. That means 100, 100 for 10 times she has to pay. At that time, she has not only pay 100 rupees, but also she has to pay some interest, maybe 10 rupees. So every week she has to pay 110 rupees. That is the method. This model has been very much successful in the past and becoming more popular. These self-help groups are stable and it starts working on its own. Some support from NGOs, that is non-governmental organizations and institutions like NABARD and SIDBI. Once these self-help groups are running smoothly without having any problem, continuously running, they will get financial assistance from the government side or sometimes from the companies also. Non-governmental organizations also will give funds to these groups so that they can ensure their financial stability. Now, let us see what are the microfinance institutions. Those institutions which have microfinance as their main operation are known as the microfinance institutions. Microfinance provides an institution. So we can call them microfinance institutions. These institutions lend through the concept of joint liability group. So this group is providing, these microfinance institutions are providing helps through joint liability group, JLG. JLG is an informal group. The first one, SHG, is a formal group, but here JLG is an informal group consisting of 5 to 10 individual members who come together for the purpose of availing bank loans. What they are doing is they are coming together a group and for some specific purpose they need loan. So individually, if they are approaching for loans to the bank, means they will not give easily, they will not give without any collateral security or something, they won't give the loans. To solve this issue, they are forming towards a group called joint liability group, and they will pay the they will take the loan and they will pay back the amount also. Now, benefits of microfinance. Actually, whatever the institutions or people or whoever it may be, whatever we take, there is a positive aspect. Okay, there will be a negative aspects. So, what are the positive aspects or benefits of microfinance? Number one, collateral free loans. Most of the microfinance institutions or companies seek no collateral for providing financial credit. The minimum paperwork and hassle-free processing make them a suitable option for quick fundraising. So here they compulsorily they don't want to give any collateral. Suppose if you take loan from even from the money lenders, they will ask for some paperwork or some other materials or something. They will ask for collateral. But here, when we take loans from the microfinance, there is no need of that one. Second, disperse quick loans under urgency. The financial crisis is inherently unpredictable. We cannot predict the when we need when we are in an emergency need of money. So at that time, it could creep up at any point of time without intimating anybody. Thanks to microfinance companies that can provide secure and collateral-free funds to an individual in the demanding situation to meet their financial need. Whenever a person is in urgent need of money, these financial institutions, these microfinance institutions will provide quick disbursement of loans. Third, provide an extensive portfolio of loans. Microfinance companies are not only limited to providing emergency credit, but also capable of disbursing housing loans, business loans, working capital loans with the minimum formalities and processing. So portfolio means different areas they are providing, different aspects they are providing loans. That is the extensive portfolio here. Fourth one, promote self-sufficiency and entrepreneurship. Microfinance companies can provide much need funds to an individual for setting up a healthy business that seeks minimum investment and offers sustainable profit in the long run. Thus, these companies ensure entrepreneurship and self-sufficiency among the lower income group. Actually, we have learned that it is meant for the poor people. So, in that poor people, they try to promote self-sufficiency and entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship means to start new business, help to start new businesses. Fifth, help people to meet their financial need. Microfinance companies are dedicated to serving the poor and unemployed individual by providing them easy financial credit. These are the positive aspects of the microfinance. Now let us go through the limitations of microfinance. Whatever the institution or programs launched by the government or anything, there will be some limitations. Here, let us see what are the limitations of the microfinance. The first one, harsh repayment criteria. Actually, it is very easily providing the loan, but the repayment criteria is very harsh, very difficult. In the absence of the legit working protocol and compliances, legit means written. There is no written protocol for the repayment. Microfinance companies could adopt a harsh repayment approach that someone would not prefer in the state of the financial crisis. Easy debt never comes with relaxed conditions. And that is something true with the microfinance companies as well. Since these companies work under strict compliances, they could manipulate their customer for repayment unethically. So they have to pay frequently. If they are not paying, means the group will be responsible. Not only one person, the group will be responsible for that one. It will be an addition burden to the group members also. So this criteria is a negative point. Now, small loan amount. Unlike mainstream financial banks, microfinance companies offer a smaller loan amount since these banks do not ask for collateral against the credit. The disbursement of the large loan amount is practically impossible in their case. So actually, they are not providing very huge amount of loans, only small amount of loan, as especially meant for the poor people. Next, third one, high interest rate. Another problem with the microfinance companies is that they were unable to render low interest based loans. This is because they don't follow traditional banks' footprint, where the accumulation of funds is easy, plus they have to borrow money from these banks to execute appropriately and allocate some part of its risk management. Hence, operating cost per transaction is quite high for them, despite the high volume of the transaction per day. Here, in this microfinance, there is high rate of interest that we have to know. Next, fourth problem is debt trap. If the credits received from the groups, it is very easy to receive credits, okay, and are not used for income generation purpose, it will lead to debt trap and may even lead to suicide. Actually, whatever the amount is taken, if they are not using for the purpose it is given for. For example, to start to improve their cottage industry or something, they have taken a loan. But actually, they used that money for consumption or enjoyment, tours like that, they used the means. They will not be able to repay that one. Suppose if they are using the amount for improving their cottage industry or something like that, automatically they will generate income and they will be able to repay the loan. But if they are not using for the purpose it is given, they will not be able to pay that amount back. Again, if they want to repay the loan, they have to take another loan. So they will be in debt trap. Now, let us conclude. This is analysis. If we take the positive aspects, its effect on economy, it is one of the best program to develop the developing and undeveloped countries. But when we take care of the negative aspects, it will give an opposite idea. In India, the microfinance has succeeded with a repayment rate up to 98%. In the microfinance institution, the repayment percentage is very high. As you see, it is 98% reported all across the country. From the states like AP, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, West Bengal, and Odisha. This tells us that microfinance has certainly has the capacity to reduce poverty by a great margin. But this is some of the few examples from our country. But because of its negative impact, it has achieved much less than what its proponents said and it would achieve. Actually, because of this negative effect, actually, it had happened in Andhra Pradesh also due to this debt trap. They were forced, some of the members of the group were forced to commit suicide. That happened in 2016, like that. And so, if you are not utilizing properly this program, it will have an adverse effect. If you are using this program in a positive manner and if you are taking care of the best aspects of the microfinance, it is a very best tool for reducing the poverty. It is one of the important measure that we can use for eradicating poverty.